All right, Bayley. I'm super excited for this because I think I've had one professional athlete on the podcast ever. And it's always fun getting, like, at least for me, maybe this is selfish, like getting into the mind of a professional athlete and somebody that's doing what you're doing at your level. But it's even better for me because obviously you are a client of mine and I get to do your training and everything. So this is going to be really fun to introduce you. You have a really high reputation in WWE because you are the, and you can correct me if I'm wrong on anything, but you're the Smackdown Champion still. And I believe the longest reigning champion as
Yes.
well. So I want to get into that, but essentially, Bayley, WWE, one of my clients, good friend, really inspiring individual. Let's dive right into your story. I mean, first and foremost, can you tell the listeners who you are and what you do in a nutshell?
So like you said, I work for WWE and I have wrestled for them for a little over 7 years. And right now I'm the current SmackDown Women's Champion. I'm actually the first ever and only woman in WWE that's Grand Slam champion. So I've held all the championships in WWE, starting with NXT, which is another promotion, which used to be kind of like a training ground, but it's now just a third brand on the USA Network. I've been Raw Women's Champion, which is our other show on the USA, first ever Women's Tag Team Champion, and current SmackDown Women's Champion. I think I got lucky. I've loved wrestling since I was a kid, and it was just all I wanted to do. I played sports in school and growing up. I was huge into basketball. I played volleyball, cross country, track, all that stuff. But once I got into high school and I was insanely obsessed with wrestling, like I wore my wrestling t-shirts to my basketball games. My coach used to yell at me to not wear those t-shirts. I wore them at school. I tried to dress like my favorite wrestlers. And every paper I wrote in class, whether it was about supposed to be, write 500 words on where you want to be in 10 years, or where's your favorite country you want to go, or whatever it was, I try to like link it into wrestling, and it was all I could think about. So when I turned 18, I started wrestling because there's a local school here in Newark, California called Big Time Wrestling, and kind of just, I just went from there. And it was in this little warehouse, just a wrestling ring, two chairs, and like a mini fridge, and I could literally stick out my hand and touch the wall. It was nothing, but I was so in love with it, and I was the only girl there, which was awesome because they treated me like one of the guys, and I felt like I had to prove myself. And I wanted to like be as good as them. And they kind of saw, at the time women's wrestling was just not so highlighted as it is now. And then I, long story short, trained for 4.5 years, traveled a little bit, learned as much as I can, and I got noticed for a tryout and did my tryout in LA for the WWE. And now I'm here, 7 years later.
I love that. That's so wild. What were there people that you specifically looked up to that like really got you thinking about this or like got you to take that full step? Because I even remember like I remember being a little kid and it was WWF, like having like the action figures and the video games and everything like that. So I agree, like growing up, it was a big part of like what me and my brother, especially my brother, watching everything. But were there certain characters and people and athletes that you really followed and were like, I'm gonna be that?
So like same with like my brother and my sister. We all watch wrestling together, and then they all grew out of it. But my brother and I used to wrestle in the living room and make up our own wrestling names. Like I was Falcon, and we called it WFK, which was wrestling for kids. It's so cheesy to think about now. But I loved the Hardy Boys and Lita were my idols. They were just so cool and different. They were so athletic. I can't do any of the things that I thought I wanted to do as a kid. They were like high flyers and flipping off ladders. And Lita was like such a tomboy. And she was someone that you didn't really see in the women's division back then. She wore baggy jeans. She wore like a choker necklace. She had bright red hair. She was so cool. And I was such a tomboy, still am growing up. And I was like, man, that chick is like who I want to be. And Trish Stratus, Kurt Angle, Stone Cold, The Rock, Eddie Guerrero, there's just so many of them. I was like such a fan of everybody, but the Hardy Boys and Lita really made me push myself because I love their story too. I would watch their DVDs and they had such a great story.
One thing I really wanted to ask you is, so Once I started working with Chad, that's when I actually, like, full transparency, started, like, diving back into, like, all right, let me look into this stuff and see what they're doing. Because I think, like, I know the physical demands, but, like, I don't really know until I started talking with him and started learning what you guys do and how brutal it can be. So I started, like, digging into stuff, and I started looking at a bunch of different people's pages, and bios and things like that. And I actually read this in your bio originally, too. You always have a smile on your face. Like, and I wanted to ask you, like, was that different? Because sometimes it's looked at, like, very hardcore, and, like, people are, I mean, some of the women are, like, I wouldn't even fuck with. Like, they're brutal. But, like, every time I talk to you, you're so positive, you're so happy. And you show that on your Instagram, too. So it's, and you can see it when you're competing. So it's not just like a on and off switch. But I'm just curious of what made you, like, be able to do what you do and stay positive like that.
That's funny, because my trainer, when I first started, he used to yell at me for smiling all the time. Like, I was learning how to take the bumps, like the stuff that hurts, learning a suplex, that stuff freaking hurts, and every time I would land, I was smiling. He's like, what are you smiling for? Like, it hurts. And then trying to teach me, you know, the emotions through the matches, I was like, I'm just having so much fun, and I didn't even realize I was smiling. But that, I think, really helped me when I was developing, you know, like my Bayley character in the past. It was just, I just try to think of, honestly, I was having the time of my life because I was living my dream. And I would try to think about how it was when I was a kid and a teenager, and what I loved about wrestling and what made me love certain characters and certain wrestlers. I try to bring that out. So I always, like, in the back of my head, I always want to make the fans feel how I felt as a kid. So I just kind of kept that in my head. And, honestly, as time goes on, of course, it gets harder, and you know, you want to get higher in the ranks, and you have more goals, and, you know, backstage gets harder, and then it becomes, you know, not such a dream come true anymore. It's like, you want to be the best and, like, elite in this. So it can get frustrating, but luckily we work with, like, amazing people, and I have a best friend that I get tagged with every week, Sasha Banks, who really just makes me happy. And just makes me want to push myself every single day. And I have a great support system in my family and friends. So, of course, it gets hard. But, you know, it's easy to smile when you're doing something like this, I guess.
Totally. I think it's easier to stay motivated to keep working when you're super grateful. Like, when you have a lot to be grateful for. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Do you have any advice for people on like, it sounds kind of cheesy to say chasing your dreams, but I think you're, like, literally the epitome of somebody who literally chased their dreams and made it happen. And I think if a lot of people are, like, watching and they're, like, seeing The Rock and they're like, I'm going to do that. Like, that guy inspired me. Like, it sounds far-fetched to a lot of people.
Yeah.
You literally did that. So, like, what do you think has to shift in somebody's head to, like, keep pursuing that? Like, what, I mean, is it just a matter of passion? Like,
definitely passion. And I don't know how you can do what we do or anything at a level, like at a professional level, without having passion for what, like, even what you do is just what everybody does and chooses to do for work. You have to be passionate about it, because that's what's going to keep you happy. That's going to want you to keep getting better and help those around you. But for me, and like you said, it sounds so cheesy, but you have to, like, believe in yourself, and you have to just trust your dreams, trust your heart. Because I always had this crazy feeling. I would dream about it every single day. I would dream about me as a kid jumping the barricade and running in the wrestling ring and just be like, whoa, I did it. But there's just a feeling that, like, I couldn't replace. I played basketball, you know, all through school, all through high school. I was going to play for the community college that I was going to, but it just didn't make me feel the way wrestling felt. And that's why I was like, I got to at least try and pursue this. And then, you know, I have a competitive nature too. So once I started learning it, I wanted to get better at it. And if I was bad at something, I wanted to get better and better and better. But the world is crazy right now, especially with social media. I feel like that helps a lot of people. Whatever you're interested in and whatever you're passionate in, you could most likely find someone on Instagram that does it, or, you know, you could follow routines, or you could, you know, ask for help. Like, it's anything is possible. I don't even know how else to say it, but I have dreamt of this since I was 10 years old, and I would never thought that, like, I would be right here right now. you know, with all that I've done so far, and I still want to do so much. It's just trust your heart for reals.
Yeah. I think, you know, it's funny too, is like, I said this on a podcast recently, is like, you just mentioned like a couple things and said, it sounds cheesy, but, and I think if people have their perspective as like, that's a cheesy saying, I don't think they're going to buy into it. But if you really look at like all the successful people throughout life, they all say very similar things that sound cheesy, quote unquote, but that's not a coincidence, right? It's not a coincidence that all of them do the same things and act the same way and have the same perspective.
Yeah. And if you like you said, The Rock, if you listen to his story, he started out as a poor kid, didn't have anything. And he just said he wanted to make money and he started lifting weights because he wanted to take care of his mom and take care of his family. So like, you start out at nothing sometimes and you can make it happen for yourself. Like, it's just, it's crazy. Sounds cheesy, but it's real.
Yeah, exactly. Speaking of The Rock, I believe one of his descendants you have beef with, am I correct?
Oh yeah.
I actually just realized this not too long ago because I saw a post she did and I was like, damn, she's hating. And then I saw one from you and I was like, oh, she's talking shit back. I was like, okay. And it was funny because I like, my wife saw me looking at it and she loves like total divas. She knows about all the female wrestlers and stuff like that. Yeah. So she was like, oh yeah, like, let me tell you. And just starts like breaking it down for me. It was super funny.
That is funny. So her name's Tamina Snuka. She's the daughter of Superfly Jimmy Snuka. We just started, you know, the storyline, and she's awesome. Like, well, right, you know, I'm supposed to hate her, but she's like, she's been in the company for 10 years, and she comes from, you know, the Samoan family, which is such a, you know, the Usos and like The Rock and Roman Reigns and all them. They're such a legendary family. That is very intimidating, but she's, you know, never had that like title match, really, that championship match at a pay-per-view and a storyline that's all about her. So I'm really excited for this, and she's really bringing it. Like you said, she's posting these videos that, like, how am I supposed to come back? How am I supposed to have a comeback for that? It's so good. Yeah. And she's, she just got some, like, you know, when she looks at me and we're doing SmackDown or whatever, and she has that like scary look in her eyes. It's like, I'm trying to be scary back, but I'm not going to intimidate this big old Samoan chick. she's awesome. And it's been a lot of fun, but I'm a little worried. That's who I have a match with, Money in the Bank on, I think it's May 10th or something.
Yeah. Well, I would say too, like, if you're looking back with a smile, I think that's in a different way, just as intimidating.
Yeah. Yeah. Like, I don't faze her.
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah, I got her where I want her.
Yeah, if you can smile back, that says a lot. So over this last almost decade, I guess, of you being in the WWE, and just like, obviously it's been at least a decade wrestling period, right?
Oh yeah. Yeah. I started in 2008 was my first match.
In that journey of just going through training and traveling and working until you got to WWE and then moving up the ranks and basically taking over everything, what have you learned? Like, what have been the biggest life lessons and takeaways you've had from this life? Because you don't live a normal life. Like, it's really outstanding. So what have you taken away from that? I know that's a really loaded question, but.
I'm only learning these things like recently, because, you know, the first 5 or 6 years I was kind of just along for the ride and trying to do as much as I can and make as much money as you can. But just recently I just started really appreciating, you know, we complain a lot, or we're like so tired about traveling and having to be on all these flights and stuff, but I just recently started appreciating, I get to meet so many people. Like, yeah, we get to travel everywhere, we get to see things we don't ever really get to explore because we're so busy, but we meet people in the lobbies, and this goes for fans and just random strangers that like stewardess or people that are checking your ticket or someone in the airport and you're sitting at a layover that just starts talking to you. Like one time on a layover, my flight kept getting delayed and delayed and delayed. And I met this guy who was asking me about the book I was reading. And, you know, at first I'm just like, who's this guy trying to talk to me? Like, I don't want to talk to you. Okay. But then he ended up, I learned that he's a life coach, and he started offering me, you know, he's like, here's my Instagram. If you have any questions, you know, actually I went to school for this, and I'm going to school to take these classes and read these books. So like, I talked to him once in a while about just life coaching stuff, like, how, okay, so this is where I'm at in my life. Where, what's the next step? Just like meeting people and realizing you can learn from every experience and from everybody that you meet. And I think just trying to like take time for my mental health too, because I get a lot of, and I just realized during this actual quarantine that I kind of like get anxiety over things, and I'm just trying to like prioritize my mental state, and that goes into traveling and this crazy profession.
I think it's pretty wild. I've had some conversations with clients that are similar, where they're getting anxiety about going back to normal life. Like, they're getting so
right.
Now they're like, I'm getting freaked out of like, what's it going to be like when I have to go back to work and I have to have all these responsibilities and I have to travel more. And it's like, it's wild, because it started with having this anxiety of being trapped, and now it's like changing, because you get comfortable, you get like in your flow, and you kind of get complacent.
Yeah. And like, things are going to be so different when you start, you know, people start going back to work, and there's going to be all these restrictions. It's going to be so weird, but we have to just like keep adapting and know that it's going to be okay, I guess.
Yeah. It's a weird time to be alive, that's for sure.
Yeah.
But you brought up traveling, and I definitely want to touch on that, because your guys' schedule normally when we're not going through this is insane. So my biggest question is, like, how do you keep it together? Like, how do you focus on, like, I think one of the hardest parts that I struggle with, because I work with you, Chad, and I actually work with Jessica, one of the refs, and like sleep,
Just
making sure like sleep patterns are like properly adjusted and like you're actually getting that sleep is so difficult. But like, how do you personally manage staying on point with nutrition and training and lifestyle and stress and all that stuff, knowing that you're so on the go all the time?
I think one of our first, you and Jason, when I first started working with you guys, was like, you need to sleep. And I can't, on the road, it's so hard. I have gotten better with it, because I during all of this, I've realized how much of a difference recovery can do for my body and for my mind. So I've been making sure that I've been getting sleep along with like everything else, yoga and stretching and meditating and all that. But like when I travel, like I said, my friend Sasha helps me out so much. She just like, it's just someone that I could depend on and rely on and know that as long as I have her, I'm definitely good to go. There's been times obviously when she's not there. Training is like my little getaway. Like, I have my group of people that I would train with, Seth Rollins, Becky Lynch, sometimes Cesaro, some of the Singh brothers, and that is kind of like my stress reliever or takes up a big part of my day. And it's fun for me too. When I was doing CrossFit stuff, it was just fun to do something all together and compete with each other. And as far as like nutrition, I'll bring my meals, and I would have to say it's probably like everybody, that's like my weak point, but I do bring my meals. I do eat my meals, but I just love wine. So I'll have freaking wine, or I love tequila. I'll have tequila and that'll mess me up. It's like, not that I'm like getting drunk every night, but like, I love to have a drink, and it, especially for our broken bodies, it just helps me sleep, I guess. And that might be bad to say, but
I think
training keeps me on track, and then just making sure I bring my meals all the time. You kind of just have to go with the flow and everything.
Yeah. I mean, I guess it just comes down to having a plan. Like, if you just go into it winging it, it's probably not going to work very well.
Yeah. And this, you know, during all this, it's awesome because I've actually found a morning routine, which has helped me a lot, because, you know, I never did that before. And I think I need to carry it while I'm on the road. Even when I'm gone for a couple days in Orlando while we're taping and stuff, I've been doing it. And it's just as simple as like, you know, I've been, once you hooked me up with like Top Notch, like having my freaking greens and my hydrate drink, and then I'll make my coffee and sit and make sure I read for a little bit. Then I'll go outside and get sun and meditate, and then I'll have another coffee and stretch, and then I'll get into my workout. So it's like, I need to make sure I prioritize time to myself as well first before I get my day started.
Here's another cheesy saying that goes along with that, is like, when you're on a flight, you got to put your mask on first before you can help other people. I 100% believe that that's the case with really just like delivering value through whatever you do for a living, or giving more to your family, your friends, anything. Like if you're not taking care of yourself, it's really hard to take care of others. And I'm a huge proponent of morning routine. So I'm going to hold you accountable of that, because I know I've even had, like, I had a buddy that I used to travel with quite a bit. And he used to give me shit because when we're in Airbnbs or hotels, it was like, have my routine and my supplements with me. Like, I woke up early so I could read on the deck before he got up. Like, it was like this, it's like, dude, I have to do this before my day starts, because it just puts me in control.
Yeah, definitely. I do the same thing. Like, I've been in Airbnbs and I bring my little NutriBlend, Bullet, whatever. I put all my, like, all my protein stuff and my supplements up. I make sure it's there, so when I wake up, I see it. And it makes me excited to, like, I don't know, go to bed and wake up and be like, all right, I'm going to have a good day because I'm going to feel good. But it's the same thing. Like, I wake up earlier than my fiance just so I can get away by myself and prepare myself, I guess.
Yeah, no, I'm the same way. You mentioned getting beat up, and that was something like your body getting beat up. And that's something I wanted to touch on, is like, what did you learn when you really started, like, moving up in the ranks as far as, like, what you needed to do with your body to be able to handle that? Because I think that it's like a good example of this is, you know, I train every day and I have for years, and I jumped back into men's soccer league a few years back. And I was like, oh, I'm fit. Like, it's fine. I was so dead the next day because it was like new muscles I haven't used in a long time. And it was just a different form of activity. So are there things that you've picked up along the way of, like, these are priorities in my recovery, training, the way I move my body, stuff like that, or else I wouldn't be able to hang in the ring?
Yeah, I think that it probably just comes with age and doing this for so long. So I've been doing it for, like, almost 12 years. And actually, I might be started training, like, 12 years this month. But, you know, when you first start training or doing anything, even working out, it's like, man, that they're like, that's going to hurt after 5 years. I'm like, no, I could do this forever. I don't even care. And then as time goes on and the more that you do it. So, like, this, like, I'm 30 years old right now. So I started when I was 18, and it feels much different than it is now as far as wrestling. But training, I've gotten, I've learned a lot through since I started with WWE, as far as, like, you know, we had a strength coach who coach the Texans, who came in to NXT and helped us, and I learned so much from him. And then I started doing CrossFit, and I was like, man, I feel strong, I'm gonna be indestructible in the ring. But as time went on, I felt like it was hurting me in my workouts because I was wrestling more. So it's kind of like just finding the balance of training and see how much I'm wrestling. And this past year has been the most I've ever worked this whole time I've been in WWE, like every single show. And I've been the champion for almost the whole year. So I'm doing like 4 or 5 matches a week with the traveling. And these are like 20-minute matches. So it is brutal. And I think I've been more letting myself recover. Like, if I can't move, I'm not going to go force myself to go work out. And I'm going to, you know, I've learned to, like, do some band stretches or just even do dumb yoga that I used to think was dumb, but it helps me so much. As I get older, it's just like, I listen to my body more, and training with you, like, I know it's easy to text you and be like, look, I can't move and I'm in my hotel room. What should I do? And then you'll make something up if I need it. But I feel like my body's better than it's ever been, actually, as far as how it feels. Because I'm learning as every day.
I mean, I think obviously that's music to my ears, but I think that, like, a big takeaway there is, it's actually funny. I wrote a big post about this the other day, and I basically said, like my body was in a similar place. Like, I wasn't competing, but I was pushing it so hard for so long because I thought, like, a really hard effort or a high intensity was just better. Like, more is better. Hard is better.
Yes.
And I just kept pushing and pushing and pushing, because I think a part of that is mental too. Like, you get this, like, adrenaline rush and this endorphin release when you go hard like that, but you can only do it for so long. So I think the biggest lesson there is, like, having that balance of intensity and recovery is so key for everybody, as not only as they age, but just being able to continually make progress in the gym.
Yeah. And I always think, like, back to my trainer, Jason, when I first started, is like, sometimes, so if I would train so hard the day of a show, which we trained before our shows, but then I would not be able to fully recover. And then I have to wrestle, and it would take a toll on my matches. Like, ah, I hurt my back when I was freaking doing deadlifts today, so I can't do that move. It's like what I'm taking away from my career, and what the reason I'm training is for this, you know, and I can't do it. Like when I was training, and when I was, I may have been like 19 or 20, me and my friends went on these like cement slides. You just sit on a piece of cardboard and go down. It's so fun. Go down cement slides. And it's like, we used to do it every week. But one time I went down and I was trying to stop myself, and my heel like ran into the floor. And I just, I don't know if you've ever bruised your heel, but I bruised my heel so bad. I couldn't walk. I could barely do anything. And then I went to training the next day, and we have to take like flip bumps, like front flip and land on your back, like with your feet down flat. And I couldn't do it. And he yelled at me. He's like, why are you going up? And I mean, it's different than training, because just going down some stupid slides. He's like, why are you doing something that's going to hurt you in your, you know, what you're training for and what you're trying to pursue? Like, don't be stupid. So that always sticks in my head. And it actually helps me like not do stupid things.
Yeah. No, I think that's actually a really good point, because I even get just average people that are like training to look better and feel better and have more energy and stuff like that, but then they get so run down that they're stressed out, they're lethargic, they're binging, they have no energy. And it's like, why are you doing this to yourself with something that is supposed to help you achieve the opposite, right?
Yeah.
So I think it's super important. The last thing I wanted to bring up with you, just because you are who you are, is I guess any tips or just any thoughts on the idea around like confidence, like for, especially for women, like, you're somebody who is, I mean, you're in front of millions of people literally all the time. And like, what allowed you to build that confidence and that certainty in yourself to be able to step on stage in front of so many people and compete and perform like that? Do you have anything that you consistently do, or like a period of time in your life that something happened that allowed you to kind of tap into your true potential?
It's something that everybody struggles with, you know, even us, that, you know, all the women and all the guys on TV, when we talk about this, we do these like Be a Star rallies, and which is anti-bullying. We go to schools and talk about this, because, you know, kids are bullied every single day, and for anything. And if it's their appearance or their clothes or, you know, anything that it is, it's like, they don't realize that we go through it too. And a lot of it is, for one, I'm confident in what I do, and like in my abilities to put on a match and things like that. The one thing I'm not confident in, and it's probably for a lot of people, is my appearance. Like, I'm not as pretty as her, or I wish my face looked like this, or my body was like that, or like I hate my legs. Like, I'll never wear shorts because I hate my legs. But I just stopped caring. Like, I think what hurts people now is the, honestly, the internet, because you see these people that look a certain way, and you're like, why can't I look like that? And then you read, so you post a picture and somebody like comments on it saying something negative or whatever it is, it like gets to you. So I've had to stop doing that. I've had to stop reading my tweets and stop reading my Instagram comments, or even when people are shouting stuff at you at a show that's not anything to do with my character. It's like something about how my hair looks like a boy, whatever it is. I just kind of have to stop caring and know that I'm confident in what I do, and those opinions don't matter. And as long as, like, you know, your friends and family are support you and love you, like, that's all that counts to me now. And it takes a lot to realize that.
I was going to say, it probably takes a lot of reminders to yourself too, right? Because I think it's obviously easier said than done. Like, oh, don't worry about what other people say. But I think there's really no like hack to it. It's just like, you have to constantly remind yourself what you're doing is the right thing and why you're doing it. And I think a lot of people try to put others down because they have their own insecurities. And like, that's a good reminder for people too.
Yeah, they definitely, like, if somebody's bashing on anyone, is that they have problems with themselves. And that's, you know, it's like, that's even like a learning process, is like, well, they're being mean because they're better than me. It's like, no, they just have some issues that they're trying to take out on other people, and they're jealous.
Yeah,
most of the time they're jealous.
Yeah,
I don't know if that helps, but
I think it does. I think it's just I think more than anything, you saying that you go through it too is like super helpful for people, because for women to hear a pro athlete who's a superstar on TV and has this huge following be able to say like, hey, I get it. I'm there too. Like it's a constant thing that we work on. I think that's super empowering.
Yeah. Yeah. I get it every day. Someone says I'm a terrible wrestler or my gear is ugly or whatever. I'm like, is it, am I bad now? Am I getting like worse? But then I'm like, no, they don't even know what they're talking about. Most of the time they have no idea what you're going through.
Yeah. 100%. Yeah. I love it. Okay. I'm going to respect your time. Thank you so much for coming on. This has been really fun for me. Where can everybody find you? And obviously on Instagram, but then if there's anywhere else that you want to shout out and get people to go check out your next match and stuff like that, that'd be great.
Yeah. You can watch me every Friday night on Fox. We are live every Friday on SmackDown. And I'm the champion. So I'm all over that thing, dude. Just check me out. Instagram is it's me, Bayley. I think it's me, Bayley. Yeah. My Twitter is different. That's why. My Twitter is it's Bayley WWE, and those are my only two, whatever social media things. Just watch me on Fox. It's cool. Yep. It's cool to be on TV.
I'll link those in the show notes too. And cause Bayley is not spelt the normal way. So you got to make sure you type.
Yeah. B-A-Y. Cause I'm from the Bay Area. You see?
Is that why they did
that?
Oh, I love that.
Yeah. When they gave me that name, I was like, okay, but can I spell it this way? Because, that's the only way I'm going to feel some connection to it. And now I love it.
Yeah. It was funny when you first reached out to me, cause it was you went by your actual first name. And I was like, wait, who is this? Like, and then Bayley, I was like, oh yeah, duh. Like in my head, but it's funny. Perfect. Well, once again, thank you so much for coming on. That was great.
Yeah. Thanks for having me.